So, the news of the day. Trump dumps Iran nuke deal. There we are. And on the second page, we have Trump. US is safer, now deals off. There it is. Now, reading these lines, I had a feeling of deja vu, you know, I mean. I remember must have been about 1965, maybe? Yes, must have been thereabouts. I happened to be in the house of a friend of mine, Roger Silverman, whose father, Sidney Silverman, was a prominent left-wing Labour Member of Parliament. Actually, he was responsible for the abolition of the death penalty in Britain. And Sidney Silverman was at the table. He was reading the newspaper, The Guardian. At that time, during the Vietnam War, the Republican presidential candidate was a man called Barry Goldwater, Senator Barry Goldwater, who had the brilliant idea that the way to end the war was to drop nuclear bombs on Hanoi, on North Vietnam. And his electoral slogan was as follows: "In your heart, you know he's right." I remember Sidney Silverman was reading the paper. He read this, he put the paper down, snorted, and said, "In your heart, you know he's right. In your head, you know he's a lunatic." Now, of course, I don't wish to comment on the psychological condition of the President of the United States, not to be disrespectful. I'm not an expert on the subject. But that Mr. Trump behaves in an extraordinary manner, I don't think that anyone can doubt. Here's a man that contradicts himself. I think every sentence Trump contradicts himself twice at least, if not three times. He is also he also appears to be a pathological liar. Now, I watched with interest his statement on television last night when he gave his reasons for abandoning this deal, which had been painfully put together after many months of wrangling between the different powers in 2015, with a view to preventing Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons, allegedly. Trump argued that Iran had in effect broken this agreement. He repeated the words of Benjamin Netanyahu, the leader of Israel, in his infamous television broadcast, which in a way, I don't know whether it reminded me of a game show or maybe a teacher in a class for backward children. You know, he was pointing at the pointer of the Iran lies, Iran does this, Iran does that, and so on. Allegedly with the support of hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of documents allegedly obtained by Israeli Secret Service. This was the only proof that President Trump put forward, this nonsense, because that's what it is, put forward by, for his own reasons, by Netanyahu. Yes, Iran has broken the deal, he says. Now, the truth of the matter is this. You can say what you like about the Iranian leadership and so on. You think what you like. But nobody in their right mind doubts that Iran has scrupulously observed this agreement, which limits their ability to produce nuclear weapons. I think they've reduced, under the terms of the agreement, they reduced their stockpile of uranium by 98%, no less, at a figure, I think it's 660 pounds, I can't remember exactly, fixed at that until the year 2031. Now, one would have thought that's quite a serious concession. Similarly, it's restricted the number of plants which can be used for enriching uranium for the purpose of producing nuclear weapons. One would have thought this was fairly satisfactory if you wanted to stop Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons. Yeah, but not satisfactory to Mr. Trump, it would seem, who argues that they've broken the deal. Not so. The Iranians have scrupulously maintained the terms of this deal. That's a straight lie. the International Agency for Atomic Energy has produced no fewer than 10 reports. And they've got inspectors on the ground, of course, not sitting in the White House watching Bibi Netanyahu on the television, which is all that Mr. Trump has done. 10 different reports which state clearly, unambiguously, Iran has scrupulously maintained the terms of this deal. The people who have never maintained the terms of this deal is the United States of America. By the way, that goes for Obama, not just under the Trump regime, to use that expression. The Americans didn't. They said that they'd abolish sanctions for Iran. They abolished some of them. It's lifted some of them, that it is true, which will now be reintroduced again, but not others. This is under Obama. So the Americans actually have broken their word and broken their promises. Not only this, he told other lies, blatant, brazen lies, insolent lies. Iran is supposed to be the main sponsor, state sponsor of terrorism in the world. Well, I always thought in my innocence that was Saudi Arabia, which, and that can be proven, that they're the main movers behind all the terrorism, the jihadi terrorism that takes place in the world. Trump goes on and says, no, Iran backs Hezbollah, no doubt about that. Revolutionary Guards, well, of course, that's perfectly true. But he went on to add to his list of terrorist groups allegedly supported by Iran, the Taliban and Al-Qaeda. I mean, this is incredible. Even the commentator on Channel 4 News, when they interviewed a Republican spokesman, said, look, the president has told lies. He said that Iran has never supported Al-Qaeda and the Taliban. You know that it's a lie. And the man concerned, of course, did. He couldn't deny it. He tried to bluster and blather as these people do. On the contrary, the Iranian forces in Syria, which is the main objection the Americans got, have been consistently fighting against Al-Qaeda, which is supported by the CIA and by America and by Saudi Arabia and by Israel also, by the way, who all got their hands in this wretched business in Syria. That's the main reason, actually, why Trump has taken the position that he has. The Americans are sore at the fact, very sore at the fact, that they have suffered a defeat in Syria. And Saudi Arabia has suffered a defeat in Syria. And Israel has suffered a defeat in Syria. And of course, the Iranians had a lot to do with that. They've sent forces in, there's no question about that. The same as the other powers have sent forces in on the other side, from all parts of the Arab world, financed and armed these jihadi gangsters, these jihadi maniacs, armed and financed by Saudi Arabia and by the CIA. Let's be absolutely clear about it. And of course, they're affiliated to Al-Qaeda. There's no argument about that. But of course, other parts of the Western world are not quite convinced by this latest escapade. You had the spectacle of the British government, who sent a high-powered delegation, one-man delegation, Boris the Buffoon, our beloved foreign minister, who of course is treated as a circus clown by the entire, correctly so, by the entire diplomatic international community, goes to Washington, not with demands. Boris doesn't go to Washington. His demands are to Moscow, of course, and to other places, but to Moscow, but to Washington, no. He goes there in a very respectful, not to say groveling and servile manner. He even, if you please, oh, by the way, he wasn't allowed to see Mr. Trump, of course. But he did communicate with him by his favorite TV program, which is Fox News, on the television in the morning. So he communicated the views of the British government, Her Majesty's government, to Mr. Trump via Fox News. And his demands were as follows: that if Mr. Trump would see his way not to doing this, taking this step, he should be awarded the Nobel Prize. I think that Boris Johnson should be awarded the Nobel Prize for idiocy, but there we are, that's just my personal opinion. What effect did this have? Well, not a lot, because not a lot. There were other more important people than Boris Johnson in Washington prior to him. For example, Angela Merkel, the undoubted leader of Europe. Or Emmanuel Macron, the great French leader, who was apparently a bosom pal of Trump. Trump is very fond of Macron. They appeared in public on a balcony, the family, the Trump family and the Macron family, with Mrs. Macron with the huge, rather absurd hat. I always thought it was the English upper class ladies that were distinguished by that absurd headgear, but apparently not so. And of course, what was the result of this? Well, the result is that the President of the United States urinated upon them from a great height. I'm sorry if that sounds somewhat undiplomatic, but it's the only thing I can think of. That's what he did. He treated him with absolute contempt. All the leaders of Europe were treated with absolute contempt. What is this nonsense about the friendship with Macron or the special relationship with Britain? Well, you see the value of that, of those empty phrases. No, Trump was determined from the very beginning to do what he did, and he did it in his usual Trump-like manner. Now, what will the result be? Well, you see, Netanyahu, who's one of the main people pushing for this, along with the Saudi gangsters who've been pushing for this, Netanyahu would like war with Iran sooner rather than later. He's pushing for it. The Israelis have been bombing Syria. They did so yesterday again. Apparently some missiles were shot down. And this is calculated to provoke the Iranians in particular into a conflict with Israel. The Israelis claim that they feel under threat from Iran. They're not under any threat from Iran, but Iran is definitely under threat from Israel. Interestingly enough, I note that many Israeli generals and even representatives of the Israeli intelligence community, who were allegedly quoted by Netanyahu in his infamous broadcast, have said that they were in favor of the deal, that it was a good deal. It was the best that they could obtain. But Netanyahu has got his own reasons, you see, because he's under investigation for criminal offenses, for corrupt practices. And that's why he wants to divert attention. It's part of the reason, at least. Saudi Arabia also got a bloody nose in Syria. They backed Al-Qaeda in Syria. They backed these madmen, these murderers, the jihadis and so on, but they've been defeated. And of course, Iran played a big role in that also. They're also engaged in a proxy war, a monstrous war, of which nothing is ever said, in the Yemen, in which they've condemned millions of people to a terrible death by starvation, men, women and children. These are our allies, the Saudi monsters. That's what they're doing. And therefore, there is this confrontation with Iran. As far as the Iranian situation is concerned, well, this couldn't be a bigger gift to the mullahs, to the hardliners in the regime, a better gift you couldn't imagine. It's true that the Iranian people will suffer. By the way, what hypocrisy again when Trump in his speech talks about the suffering of the Iranian people at the hands of the regime. The Iranian people are suffering considerable economic hardship at the hands of the Americans and their sanctions, and now they will suffer more. The Iranian people, the ordinary people, will suffer as a result of these sanctions. But if Trump thinks that that's going to undermine what he calls the regime, somebody on the TV last night said, well, an Iranian spokesman said, don't use the word regime, it's a derogatory term. Why not talk about the American regime, the Trump regime, the Theresa May regime? I think that's not a bad comment to make. Anyway, if Trump thinks that that's going to undermine the regime, he's very much mistaken. If there's one thing that everyone in Iran has got very profoundly ingrained on their consciousness, it's an absolute hatred of American imperialism and the crimes of American imperialism that they've committed against Iran for many decades. And therefore, this will have the effect of pushing millions of people behind the regime, if you're going to use that expression. So that's counterproductive. If he thinks it's also going to stop the Iranians from conducting their defensive activities, because that's what they are, in Syria also he's got another thing coming. No, this will have the opposite effect. The only effect that it will have, and that's why the Europeans are terrified, is to destabilize further the events in Syria and the whole of the Middle East, to increase the tendency, to increase the dangers, also to the United States. What's the man talking about? Trump, US is safer now the deal's off. The US is not safer. the US and the entire world is in a much more dangerous and bellicose position as a result of this position. Of course, the Europeans are against. They have their own reasons. It's escaped the common notice that big European companies, such as the French company Total, the oil company, or the Royal Dutch Shell company, and many other companies have got big investments in Iran. They stand a lot to lose from this latest escapade of Trump. That's partly why they put pressure on their own governments to scuttle across the Atlantic to plead with the president to please act rationally. Well, that's a lot to ask of Donald Trump, to act rationally. He acts like Donald Trump. Of course, he's surrounded by the most reactionary elements like John Bolton and so that arch-reactionary, the arch-counter-revolutionary. What we have here is a bloc of three of the most counter-revolutionary and reactionary powers on Earth. The USA, that's the main counter-revolutionary power, and Israel and Saudi Arabia, the most reactionary and counter-revolutionary forces in the Middle East. And that is a poisonous, a noxious, a horrible combination, which can mean no good for the people either of Iran, the Middle East, or anywhere else.